That's good, no?
So the work I showed you there is, I think, 2006. A challenge with that work is how you select the latent dimensionality. So the thing that, this is more of a sort of a research talk that Andreas will do, which show you some work we did in Sheffield, where we use variational approximations. You haven't had the background to understand how those are working. In fact, the material only comes tomorrow. To try and sort of extend that type of model, show you a bit of the, it's sort of like the sort of power of GPs you can get. Andreas.
Okay, hi. So yes, exactly as Nils said, because it's a replacement for the second intro to GPs, I'm not going to bombard you with many new concepts in terms of, from a technical perspective. I'm going to show you a lot of new concepts, but it's more like demonstrations. So I guess, and I'm trying to link a lot to what Nils said in the previous two lectures. So I guess the main take-home messages of this is, firstly, to understand a bit more about the two previous lectures via the examples that I'm going to show you. Secondly, appreciate a bit more the Bayesian methodology in machine learning, because Gaussian processes are Bayesian approaches. And thirdly, maybe to appreciate the cool stuff you can do with Gaussian processes. So this is the outline of this talk. It's going to be 45 minutes, not too long. And I'm going to talk about Bayesian modeling in general. And I'm going to touch on the issues of overfitting, model complexity, and Occam's razor. And then I'm going to talk about latent variable modeling in a Bayesian way with GPs. So Neil already talked about the GPLVM, latent variable modeling with GPs. Now I'm going to extend this in a fully Bayesian setting. And I'm going to show the formulation, very quickly talk about tractability issues and the advantages you get when you get past these issues. And then I'm going to just demonstrate a little bit quickly some extensions that arise from the Bayesian formulation of the latent variable models. And the reason you can get these extensions is because you have, as Neil said, principal propagation of uncertainty, so principal handling of uncertainty in the Bayesian setting. For example, deep Gaussian processes and an extension for multi-view modeling. So let me start with this, the Bayesian modeling. Right, I show you three plots here. The first plot is some data that we have. So the data is one-dimensional. We have the inputs on this axis and the outputs on the vertical axis. And these axes are the data we have. And here is two fits to the data. And I want to ask you which curve fits the data better. So, okay, who says the blue? Okay, so a few people. Who says the red? Right, so I think you have a bias there. So which curve is more complex? Who says the blue? Okay, right. And which curve is better overall in terms of modeling? Who says the blue again? All right, so I said some people have bias because when I asked this, I think many people were thinking about the better curve, right? Yes. Yes, exactly. So that's why I put it in quotes, because nothing is really defined here, and that's why I made it interactive. I want to see the intuitions. So I'm going to talk about this more in the following. The easiest way to define something complex is to say that it has a lot of parameters or many degrees of freedom, for example. Okay, so we all agree this is a better fit, even if this passes from the data exactly. So it's, in some sense, it fits the data better. And what you really want is this, right? So this is actually a GP fit. This is a stupid fit that I did by playing around. Yes, so we want a good balance between data fitting and avoiding overfitting. So avoiding this situation where you fit very well your data, but this is a bit mysterious, right? Because you see, there's a very small area where you don't have data here and something stupid is happening because this curve here is complex, so it just varies wildly. And okay, so how do Gaussian processes solve the overfitting problem? Okay, there are many answers to this. So the answer that I want to say is that they integrate over the function itself. So that's what Neil was talking about in the first lecture. And this is associated with the Bayesian methodology, because by integrating over the function, then it means that you average out over all the possible function forms under a prior. So what you do is that you say, okay, I'm putting a prior on the forms of my function, and I'm going to integrate out the whole function. So let's compare this, for example. Here is a parametric model, and it's, let's say it's something like this. So you have your inputs through some kernel or whatever, some function, and the parameters here to get the output. And here you have this formulation of the noise model. This is actually the Gaussian process that I'm going to talk about in this line. So in the maximum likelihood case, what you do is that you try to find the argmax of W of the parameters. So you just take the likelihood, what is your data given the parameters and x, and you try to find the best possible set of parameters. And in the Bayesian setting, in the Bayesian non-parametric setting in this case, what you do is that you say, well, since I don't know what is my function, I'm going to just integrate over it. And because a function is more infinite dimensional, we use the Gaussian process prior here. So if this was a vector, we just put a normal prior. So that's what exactly is happening in the Gaussian processes, right? That's from the first lecture. And now we just have some theta here, the parameters of the covariance function, but this is hyperparameters. They're not parameters of the actual noise model, let's say. So that's the difference here. And as we know in the Gaussian process, this Bayesian approach is what is balancing the complexity with the data fitting. So, good. So now I said a lot of things and I put a lot of quotes and so on. Maybe I will be a bit more specific now as to what does it exactly mean to follow a Bayesian approach a bit more formally somehow. So that's what I'm going to say in the next slides. And then also, what does this have to do with avoiding overfitting and controlling model complexity? So let's formalize it a bit. Okay, so what we want to do is to assume a hypothesis or model, calligraphic M, and a distribution of the parameters, theta. So we will say that we will have a prior over the parameters. And then we assume a likelihood for the observed data, D, given the parameters. A posterior, so what is the value of the parameters given the data, but we want this to be a distribution. And the normalizer of the posterior is the model evidence. So you will see everything fitting together with through the Bayes rule. Can you see this? It's very light green. So the probability of a specific set of parameters given my data and given the model, everything's conditioned on the model, obviously, right? On the construction of the model. So the probability of a set of parameters given the data and given the model is, through Bayes rule, the probability of my data given the parameters times the prior on the parameters, and to get the proper distribution, you need to divide by the marginal likelihood, which is also called evidence. This is very important. So the marginal likelihood is just the numerator. So it's just a numerator, but you integrate out all the possible values of the parameters. So it's telling you what's the probability of my data given the model for every possible setting of the parameters. And how many of you have seen the Bayes rule before? Oh, okay, so that's great. So maybe that was too simple for you. So I have something simpler for you then in the next slide, how this relates to model complexity. So I have some clip art here. Perhaps you have seen this picture before. Not exactly this because I made this, but something like this. So have this setting here, and we want to make some sort of inference what's happening behind the tree. So there are some outcomes here. We have these outcomes. So some of these outcomes are more probable. Some are more complex as well, right? So this is very complex because, I mean, but it has non-zero probability. This could happen, right? Also, this could happen, or this. So what we want to do is to do inference, but have some sort of notion of the complexity of what we are talking about. So my prior is that clowns don't appear out of nowhere. So in the Bayesian formulation, we say that this is probably not what's going on. And maybe my prior also said that there is some smoothness in solid objects, so maybe this is not what's going on either. So yes, we want to balance these things when we make inferences. That's what we, like us humans, do, I guess. So let's see this more formally again in practice. So this is again Bayes' rule, what I showed you before, and I'm going to focus here. Again, sorry, I'm missing here the prior. And I'm going to focus on this term. It's called the evidence. So here is a figure from David Mackay, but I think the specific would be from Garamani and Rasmussen. Anyway, so in this figure, what I did is that, what they did, is that we assume that all possible data sets of size n can be sorted in the real line, let's assume. So this line here is all the possible data sets. Every point is a different data set. And the vertical axis is the probability of this data set given the model. So it's the marginal likelihood, right? And here I have three different models. So that's why I have three different curves. I have the two simple, the green, the so-and-so, the magenta, and the two complex, which is the blue. I will explain what's going on, but what I want to show here is the notion of Occam's razor. So you can explain, it's a philosophical notion, and one saying related to it is that a plurality is not to be posited without necessity. Or another quote from Einstein, everything should be made as simple as possible, but not simpler. So, and I think the second is a bit more intuitive in this case. Right, so what I want to show you here is how complexity and this evidence that you get from the Bayesian methodology are linked. So if we have a too complex model, my argument is that this distribution is going to be very wide. Why? Because the complex model has many degrees of freedom, is so complicated that can model many, 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 many data sets. On the other hand, the too simple model can model very, very few data sets. So let's say it's a linear model. And because these are distributions, they have to normalize. So if you want to model more things, you have to distribute somehow your the mass. So when you do have a specific data set that is lying here, then the evidence is going to be smaller for the complex model than for the this model, which is in the middle. So of course, this is an automatic trade-off, because you do want your curve to capture the data that you have. So you don't want the too simple model, because it doesn't even capture this. But you don't want it to be too complex, because the too complex is just modeling everything, so it says nothing. So this shows somehow how the model evidence arising from the Bayesian methodology is related to automatic complexity. So what you really want is to have the model evidence as a measure of, as an objective function of which model to use. So P of data given model, that's what you want to use. Exactly, so the evidence is higher for the model that is not unnecessarily complex, but still explains the data. That's exactly what we want to have. Right, so let's move on from here. So that was part one, and in the part two, I'm going to show how we can actually do this in the GP case, and more specifically in the GPLVM case, in the latent variable variant of the Gaussian process family. So let's start with the formulation a bit. That's again the data I showed you in the first slide. You have the inputs and the outputs. But if you remember from the previous talk from Neil, in the unsupervised case, we don't actually have the inputs, right? So what we actually have is this. Oops, is this. We have just this, just the outputs. And you can see this is very complex, right? So it's very difficult to decide what is the mapping function and what is the actual inputs. So that's only what we have. So that's a very difficult problem, because the x's are also missing. So the improvement we want to do on the GPLVM, on the model that Neil talked about before, is to say, OK, we need to infer these x's. So if we think of these x as parameters, then we want to treat them in the Bayesian way, as we do with the parameters of the mapping, let's say. And this is what I'm showing here. So here we have the GPLVM objective. It's familiar to you, because exactly the same, pretty much, as the Gaussian process objective. So on the top, you have the likelihood, the probability of your outputs given the inputs and the hyperparameters, which is arising by just integrating out f, right? The mapping with the Gaussian process prior. And what you want to do is to find the argmax of this, but notice that I have x here because it's the unsupervised case, so x is unknown. So I want to find the maximum over it as well. So in the Bayesian case, I want to say that this is Bayesian with respect to f because we integrate out over the mapping with the prior, but it's still not Bayesian with respect to x. It's more like maximum a posteriori or maximum likelihood from this objective. So in the Bayesian objective, what we want is this here. So here is very this is very similar to the first, but we just marginalize out x, all the possible settings for the latent space. So p of y given theta is just this. So what I'm doing is just taking the objective above this quantity and also integrating out over x. So I have to put a prior over x and integrate out to get this. And then there's no x here, right? So just do the argmax of theta. Everything is conditioned on the model actually here as well. And this is fully Bayesian. So this is the Bayesian GPLVM of Titius and Lorentz. Right, so now this is the marginal likelihood, is the evidence that I was talking about in the previous slides, right? Because we integrate out over x. You can see it here. So you have your likelihood, y given x, the prior p of x, and p of y, the evidence. And of course, this we have by model construction. This is what we want to find. And if we have all this, we have the posterior. So we still have an estimate of the latent space of x, the low dimensional representation of y if it's dimensionality reduction. But we have a distribution over it posterior. And this is very important. I don't think I have time to talk about this. I can maybe outline it a bit. So what I want to show here is that doing this Bayesian methodology comes at a cost. And the cost is that it's intractable. It's not something easy to do. Because as I said in one of the previous slides, Bayesian approach means average out over all possible settings. And you can imagine this as very complicated. Okay, you can see it here, but I'm not going to in detail. I just want to point out that you can write the integral like this. You can come back in the end if you want. And what you need to do is have the prior density being propagated through a nonlinear mapping, and this is intractable. And the solution to this intractability is a variational approximation. So again, it's good if you just get the general concept here, because I think Alan and James are going to talk a little bit about similar issues in a more formal way. Right, so we want to compute this, the marginal likelihood, right? So we want to integrate out over x. And notice that in this slide, conditioning on the model m and theta is dropped, but it's there. So since we cannot find this, the variational approximation is going to find a quantity that's always smaller or a bound. How many of you know about variational methods? If you can raise your hands. Okay, about half. So yes, in the high level, what we want to do is use f as an objective. And if we try to maximize this objective, we will approach closer and closer to the marginal likelihood. And of course, since we will not have obtained this, but only an approximation, then also the posterior is not going to be exactly the posterior, but some approximation. So now we have an approximation to the posterior of the latent space. And as I said, you can think of the latent space as parameters. So what's the probability of having this setting for the inputs of the GP given the data under this specific model? And because we follow the Bayesian approach, this is going to automatically handle the complexity. So it's going to give us a latent space that is not very complex. So what would be a complex latent space, for example? So what would be a complex set of x's? Could be a set of x's that is very high dimensional, right? Okay. So, do you have any questions so far? I don't have many technical things afterwards. Okay, that's good or bad. So, yeah, you can interrupt me even later if you remember a question. Okay, so just to recap a bit, what we have so far, we have the Gaussian process framework, and where you have the outputs given the inputs, and then you say, okay, the inputs are not observed now. And what we are doing is that we want to find the mapping that is giving us the outputs from the inputs. That's the standard Gaussian process. And in this case, in the supervised case, we also want to find the inputs. And in the Gaussian process case, we take the Bayesian approach and we say, okay, we're going to find to integrate out over the mapping. So we're going to average over all possible settings for the mapping, given a prior. So the idea is here to do the same for the inputs. Average over all possible settings for the inputs under a prior. That's all we have done. But this, if it sounds simple as a concept, unlocks a lot of good properties. So firstly, the training is now robust over fitting. It's exactly what I was saying before, right? So you will not get some, like the very complex line that I showed in the first slide. You will not get some, in this case, you will not get a very complex latent space. You will get something that is simple, but not too simple that doesn't fit your data. You can do more natural handling of missing data. I don't have time to talk about this. Perhaps Alan will talk about this. No? Okay, he will not talk about this, but you can do it. And what you can do is detect the dimensionality of the latent space automatically, because the dimensionality is some sort of complexity. Another thing you can do is incorporate priors for the latent space. So if you have site knowledge, then okay, why not take it into account? And how can you take it into account? Through a prior. That's good. And then some structural extensions. So now we'll talk about the automatic detection of the dimensionality. So now we'll just make explicit that the latent points X, right? So the inputs that are unobserved, so they are called latent, are multidimensional, so I have Q dimensions. And here on the top, we have the exponentiated quadratic covariance function that Neil talked about. So if we have a mapping from the inputs to the outputs, we have a function that is constructing the covariance matrix for the relationship, right, of the Gaussian. And it has this form. It's exactly as Neil showed. And now there is a different covariance function that is extremely similar. The similarity is that you have a different parameter, which is called length scale per dimension. So X has many columns, as Neil was explaining. And now for every column of X, you have a different parameter. I will say what this parameter means, but that's a different form. This one, I summarize it on the top, different format, is the same thing, to explain it. So this is a covariance function. And the length scale across input dimension j is telling us how big the difference has to be, how big the difference in the input space in jth dimension has to be in order for the corresponding output to vary to change significantly. So how much do I have to move in xj in order to see a noticeable difference in f of x? So if this parameter is tending to infinity, then saying that, well, you have to move infinite distance to see a change. But you can't move infinite distance, so this means that you will never see a change. So in some sense, along dimension j, the function does not vary. So it's irrelevant. You don't need this dimension, right? Equivalently, you can think of Wx as being weights, so it's the inverse of this. So Lj will go to infinity, the weight will go to zero. So by having a different length scale per dimension, you can do some sort of selection of the features, or in the GPLVM case, you can do selection of the dimensions. So if one dimension is not needed, it can be deemed as irrelevant, and we can just throw it away. So this is a way of, one way of, Yes, regularization. That's what you said, right?
Yeah.
Here you can see it in practice. So here I have the old data. It's just a data set where, which is 12 dimensions in the outputs. And this is, you do dimensionality reduction. And the data have three different classes. So you have 1,000 data points belonging to three different classes. But the actual observations are 12 dimensional. So if you use the GPLVM to get a latent space, and you use this covariance function, then the scales are like this. So they say, OK, you initialize with 10 dimensions. I need all 10 of those. Now, if you use the Bayesian version, it will say, OK, you gave me a 10-dimensional latent space, but I don't need most of the dimensions. I need only two dimensions. And if you plot the low-dimensional representation, if you plot this x now, you can see that also it gets a better separation. So it says, what I need to do is to separate these three classes. And to do so, I need just two dimensions. So it says that the dimensionality of this data inherently is two-dimensional. It's not 10-dimensional. So with the Bayesian complexity control, you can recover this automatically. So I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that this here is exactly these length scales, right? So x is 10-dimensional initially, and I have 10 length scales. And I optimize them under the Bayesian framework, and 8 of them go to 0, well, go to infinity.
So this is very similar to L1 regularization?
Yes, exactly. So in the Bayesian paradigm, you can get the equivalent of L1 and L2 regularization by putting a Gaussian prior, let's say, or a Laplace. So it's the same effect from a Bayesian standpoint, where you use priors. OK, we're happy with this. Are you happy with this so far? Or have a question? Yes.
Can you go back to the previous slide?
This one?
Yeah. Is there any connection between this relationship and the relationship between the EM algorithm for GMMs and the variation on the EM algorithm for GMMs?
Mm-hmm.
Because it kind of reminds me of the same thing. If you do the EM in the variational setting,
mm-hmm.
it kind of automatically detects the number of components.
The variational EM is for the GMM, is a way of, if I'm not mistaken, to do a Bayesian training for the, it's an algorithm so that you can have a Bayesian treatment of GMMs, right?
Yes.
So it's so pretty much the same thing, yes.
Select the number of components.
Yes, here instead of GMM, we have the GPLVM. But this is not so close to clustering as explicitly, let's say, but yeah, it emerges by just learning the structure of the data. Yeah? Yeah, that's a good, well, so this is still a GP algorithm, and GPs scale very badly with the number of data. So it's actually cubic. So if you have n data, then the scaling is O n cubed. Here there is some other things going on. There is some sparsity that James is going to talk about. So this is built upon the sparse Gaussian process framework. So James is going to talk about this tomorrow. But what you have to keep in mind is that this is pretty much theoretically the same scaling as GPs. In practice, there is a factor in front of it. So it's like 10, O, and but something like this. Right? OK. So we talked about the detection of dimensionality. And now I want to talk to you about the incorporation of priors for x. So if you have side information about what the latent space could be or could look like, then why not incorporate it through the prior? So again, this is the Bayes rule. And now I'm talking about this part here, about the prior. Here we don't have theta, we have x, right? It's like parameters. Right, so in general, instead of having p of x, yes, so this is the Bayes rule for the Bayesian GPLVM. In general, we can have x to depend on some parameters or other information. And here I just want to demonstrate that, yes, well, an example is that if your observed data is a time series, so if your observed data is smooth, right, then you have reasons to believe that the low dimensional representation of this data perhaps should also be smooth. So you're going to enforce some correlations in the latent space, correlations in these low dimensional points. And yes, one way to make this would be to say that you put a prior P of x given time. So x is coupled with time, that the time information of each x being observed. Or what you can do is that x can even be cast as a function. So x is x of t, is a function of time. So directly you cast as a function. And then you put a Gaussian process prior over it. So OK, if this is too complicated, I don't want to go into the details. It's just a high-level concept, more of an excuse to show you some nice videos later. If you put a Gaussian process prior on the latent space, then you have a structure like this. So this is the Gaussian process that you have seen in the first lecture. So from inputs, you go to function outputs through Gaussian process with a covariance matrix K, sorry, covariance function. And now what you do is that you say that, OK, the inputs that are here not observed have also Gaussian process prior because they are also functions. So what you do is that you stack one Gaussian process on top of another Gaussian process. OK, this might be a bit complicated. I don't know if we, yes, question? Well, I assume here that is given. So you have the time information by which every single observation was made. So you have the timestamps. That's exactly how you put it. So you put it by just putting having them as inputs to the covariance matrix. So the mapping from the time to the latent space is given by non-parametrically with the Gaussian process. This Gaussian process now is having inputs, the time points, right? It's exactly the same as in a standard Gaussian process where you have observed inputs and outputs. You say, I have these inputs, I have these outputs. I'm going to say that my outputs are a function of my inputs with the Gaussian process. Where do the inputs go? In the kernel. So here I'm doing the same, but one level higher. So the time information goes into the latent space through the Gaussian process. And now the latent space goes into the outputs through another Gaussian process. Yeah? That's, again, high level. You have a question?
You've been assuming that x, the input, is non-observed, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what if we have both the things observed? Like, even inputs are observed together with the timestamps.
Uh-huh.
They are giving me some output.
Ah, I see. Well, in this case, you wouldn't have, if this observed, you wouldn't have any uncertainty, so it wouldn't make, I think, much sense to put a Gaussian process there.
Yeah, but so there can be a Gaussian process where the covariance matrix can be, like, I don't know, concatenation to
You mean if you have both? So if you have mixed observed and unobserved information, that's what you are saying, then you can have multi-output Gaussian processes, or you can where you have covariance matrices that try to mix both. So, but this is a bit more complicated. There are many ways to do. So, yeah, okay. So let me show you some videos now. So here's a video. Here's this in action. So what I did here is that I took a video, and I modeled every single pixel of the video with a Gaussian process with the temporal constraints. And then from this video, I removed some chunks, and I tried to reconstruct them with the Gaussian process. So when you see the green bar on top is the training video. When you see the red bar on top is the chunks that I removed, and then I reconstruct it. And then I just put everything together to see that it's smooth. So here you go. So you see that the interpolation is quite good. When the head is moving, it becomes a bit blurry, because it's a bit more difficult for the Gaussian process to predict in this area. There is very little data. Yeah, and that's it. So I want to point out that this was just like 150 training examples, and this is vast dimensionality. and you can still model it. In the next video, I use a more sophisticated kernel, and which is periodic. And in this case, I had the dog running on the treadmill for very few time frames, like 60. I fitted the Gaussian process with a special covariance function that is modeling periodicity, and then extrapolated further away from the training set. So what I'm showing you here is the last five frames of the training set, and then I'm showing you the predicted sequence. You will see the predicted sequence with a red bar. And the challenge is to make this to be smooth transition, obviously. And I think this is kind of happening. You see that there is a ghosting effect in the tail, again, exactly because, because of the imperfection and because there is some sort of difficult correlation of the tail with the rest of the body is more like noisy. I don't have time to show this, unfortunately. So I'm just going to point out that you can have, as we said before, a more more advanced choices for the covariance function, and in the top level that is saying what is your assumption about the latent space. So by using different covariance functions, you can make more and more sophisticated or more and more tailored assumptions about your latent space. For example, you can have a block diagonal structure and have independent sequences and model them all together. Okay, I think I don't have time to show this. I'm just going to jump to the extensions. Very few slides left. So one extension is how to do deep Gaussian processes. Well, this is easy, right? It's just, well, not as easy, but easy conceptually. So what I showed before is that from the standard GP, f of x, this is a GP. What I showed before is f of x of t is a stacked GP. So let me just rewrite t as x1. So now you have f of x1. X2 is a function. And then why not just, you know, it's this thing here, but I wrote the t as x1 and this as x2. Why not just keep going on and just add many layers? This would give you a deep Gaussian process. The variation approximation changes only little, and you have uncertainty in the whole structure. And this is one example of how this works in practice. I don't have time to show the video, so I will just show this. This unsupervised setting, so is this model here, but instead of having one latent space, so this would be the GPLVM. Instead of having one latent space, you have a hierarchy of latent spaces. If you train such a model, what do you get? You get some sort of increasing abstraction in your representation. So what I did here is that I took this model and I sampled from every layer. So I sampled latent points from every layer, and then I project it to the output space through the mappings so that I get outputs. So by doing this, I see what kind of information what each layer is showing to me. And what I see is that in the layers closest to the data, I get very general very general features, very general signals being encoded, such as in this digit example that Neil was showing, such as if a zero is close or not in a circle or other local kind of things. And then in the top layer, the more abstract layer that is modeling the data through intermediate feature spaces, I learned something much more abstract, such as the label. What, is it a zero, is it one, is it a six? So I get this effect from generic feature encoding to local feature encoding. And the last thing I want to show to you is the effect of expanding the model horizontally, not vertically. So in this case, instead of extending vertically, I extend horizontally in the observation space. So I want to model multi-view data. What is multi-view data? It's data where is when I have a situation to model or a phenomenon, but the data that I get is different streams of information for the same phenomenon. For example, me speaking, you have the image of me, you have the sound. And obviously, these signals are going to have some overlap, but also some private information, right? For example, the color is not something that you can see, but the what I'm saying is written here, and also it's transmitted to you through my voice. And the idea is that we want to model such kind of data, multi-view data, through latent variables. This again, the same construction as the Gaussian process here, but I have two observation spaces that I call Y1 and Y2. And without getting into the details, I use this covariance function that has a different scale per dimension. You remember this from the previous slide, the one that is doing dimensionality detection, the one that's saying, so if I had one view, it would say, out of these dimensions, which ones are needed? It's like with the oil example, you could say, only the first three are needed, and the rest are not needed. I do this for this observation space, but also for this. So what's happening is that for some of those, they will agree. So for some of those, they will say, the first observation space wants the first and the third, and the second one wants the third and the last. And also this continues, so can want it more or can want it less. And then we say, okay, this is not wanted by anyone, let's prune it. And what's happening is that we say that this latent dimension has only to do with this observation space, this with the second, and this with both. Sorry if you are colorblind, this is red and green, but yeah? That's a good question. So you assume probabilistically that they're separate, but what you do is that you present the model aligned. So the first and the first, the second and the second. So if you had the video of me speaking, you'd have the first frame with the first, exactly.
That's input, right?
That's input. So you do it implicitly.
It's the output.
I'm describing the output.
Mm-hmm. Any meaningful actual correlation structure is just by the virtue of...
Exactly, yeah. So the idea is that these are high dimensional and we cannot really treat them as correlated, even we know that there is overlap signal, because they are so high dimensional and it's very difficult for us to treat them. So what we will say is that we will do some sort of joint dimensionality reduction. We want to work in a simpler space, X. And this simpler space is going to also... gives us the information about how relevant each dimension is to each of the views. So we want to find this correlation through the latent space, which is much simpler. So I'm going to show you a video here. This is the last thing I'm going to show, and then you're going to eat, I think. So I had a discussion with Carl yesterday, and he was saying that as we do animal experiments, here I use the labs called monkeys, something like this, right? So this is myself, Alan, and Javier. And these are three different observation spaces now, right? And this is exactly the data that I showed, is this video. It's this rotation. It's very few data and very high dimensional data. That's all the data I gave. And then I applied this model, and I want to find the shared and private signal in this data. And like I did with the digits, to do this, I'm going to find the latent space and sample from, and see the overlaps, which parts of the latent space is shared, which is private, and so on. So this is a shared part, and it's two-dimensional, so I can plot it. And now I can sample from it as well, right? I can just interpolate, that means sampling. And because I have the mapping from X to Y, I project to Y1 in this case, to get the outputs. And this will show me what it encodes. So this shared dimension, it's encoding the rotation, which is good because it's the thing that we know is shared, right? It's not perfect, obviously. But the good thing is that with the same signal, with exactly the same signal, if I project to the other dimension, which is to the other view, which is Alan, I also get a rotation. So what's happening is that it's true that this shared space, this shared two-dimensional space, is encoding the rotation, which is truly what is shared in this. data set. Of course, there's also other things shared. For example, I don't know, the shape of the nose of one person to the other. But here, we are the model is just saying what is more statistically significant. And then if you look on the private dimensions, you can see, OK, this is, if you look in the private dimensions, you can see things that are specific to one or the other view. So if you saw in the data set in the beginning, I was blinking, and the other guys were not blinking. So this is one of the private spaces. And if I sample from there, I get this blinking effect, which is a bit creepy. And also, it's very exaggerated because it's a generative model. So so I can just sample from it. I can just extrapolate it in the input space and can get crazy stuff. So here I get this creepy thing. And in another shared dimension, sorry, Alan. So so that's not what's... So there's some dimension that is giving some sort of lazy eye to Alan, which is not true. He doesn't have a lazy eye. But the model somehow discovered this subtle effect, maybe in one of the eyes, and just exaggerates it. So you see it's happening there. So probably the other eye is also changing, but it's too dark for now to happen. Here's a different set. This is very similar. But the data set is, again, a different bunch of guys and the different illumination condition around the faces. So you see all these people around in the lab today here. And what's a shared signal here is the light condition. And the private is the characteristics of the face. I do exactly the same here. This is a shared signal. The shared signal projected in one of the views is just giving me variations in the illumination condition. Nothing else changes, right? So if I change the phase now, this is the intensity. That's another shared signal, the intensity of the light, of the light source. And if I change the... Now I'm going to the private space. In the private space, I model phase characteristics, right? They are private to each person. Again, because it's continuous, I can interpolate between the latent space. I can get these morphing effects. So here is something between me and Max, a German Greek. So you see here there's a smooth interpolation. And what I'm going to do now is that I'm going to fix this dimension in the private space to be max and go back into the into the shared space and show that the shared space now was modeling the illumination condition for max, the same signal. So coming back to the whole Bayesian idea, the Bayesian framework is penalizing the redundancy in the latent space. So you have shared signals and private signals. You don't have many, many private signals. That's a summary. I'm slightly over time. But thanks for listening. So the summary is that the Bayesian modeling automatically balances fitting and complexity. The latent variable models are a powerful addition to the standard GP modeling, as you saw from Neil's talk. And similarly to how the mapping is treated in a Bayesian way in the GPs, we want to do the same with the latent space in the unsupervised case. I show many extensions and advantages of this arising. And I don't know what I want to say here. The key to obtaining those is the principal propagation of uncertainty. OK, that's the talk. Many of you are looking at the food already, I think. Is there food? So yes, thank you. Do you have any questions? Ah, there's one question. Sorry, guys. Don't blame her.
Well, lunch isn't set up yet, so you might as well ask questions.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was just wondering, do you do anything like goodness of fit, or you just look at your videos and decide that?
Goodness of fit?
Yeah, or any other way of deciding that your video is actually doing a good job.
OK, so the question is if I am doing some sort of goodness of fit in this example, sorry if I'm just looking at the video. So in theory, the Bayesian approach is supposed to give you the best fit under the constraint that it's not too complex.
I'm going to give you like a lot.
Yeah, it's true. So I'm not doing this. So I guess this depends on the problem that you have. So if you have a vision problem, then you have to do a different goodness of fit. And I haven't done this because I'm not an expert in computer vision. But yes, you could do it quantitatively. So here I did something quite silly. So I generated the missing frames, and then I just see the reconstruction error, which is not good to do in videos. You can do better things, I haven't. So yes, that's the answer. Yep.
In the junk video that you showed before,
yep.
Did you show just a sample from the posterior, or was it the mean?
Ah, that's a good question. So this was the mean. Yeah. So in the dog.
That's why you got the ghost effect.
Yes,
there,
yeah.
I
tried. It still doesn't look very good. And we had some discussions about how to make this better, how to make it sharp. But you know, the Gaussian process is a bit dumb in this sense, in that it models every pixel individually, so it doesn't know that it has to be sharp, the image.
So it has no, the GP is all it's doing is saying each pixel independently is run as a Gaussian process. It has no concept of which pixels are neighboring. So it doesn't see something, so when it has to move from a tail in that position to a tail in that position, it doesn't see that this is smooth to be between. So all it does is it says, okay, the way that's smooth is by this tail disappearing and this tail reappearing. Yeah. So the way it gets a smooth mapping is bringing them in and out like that. To get this sort of effect, you would need something like features that were more global, or filters that were the sort of thing people try and train in convolutional neural networks to make that smooth. The model can't sort of see it when it's trying to model each pixel independently. But we haven't really tried that, have we?
Yeah, I think it needs some domain expertise in this. But right. Other questions? Okay. Are you hungry? Yes? Good?
He's hungry, not angry.
hungry for learning more. No.
What I think we'll do is, so the lunch is being laid out in here. We'll try and get it tidied away.